Most early recording engineers didn't wear white coats. It all came in with electrical recording when everything got terribly technical and behind a glass panel. Generally speaking, the recording engineer and the artists had to muck along a little bit more together in the acoustic era, although they did tend to hide a lot of this frightening kit behind a pair of curtains at the very least, because it was both secret and, as I say, sometimes a bit frightening for people. So this afternoon, here we are with what represents a studio recording machine as opposed to a domestic machine that could have a recorder popped into it. And the main works of this are from around about 1902 Edison concert phonograph, which normally has a larger mandrel on it, but I've used it so I can get a flywheel on the end there, which allows us to record slightly more steadily than with the original motor. Onto the top of this, we have what they call a trunnion. Now, this trunnion takes the sound that's being funneled. Am I off mic now? I'll come round this way. I don't know what they can see because I don't know where the cameras are pointing. So the sound has to be gathered by the end of a horn. We will choose the one appropriate to the job. It travels to the end here where it's at a much higher pressure, and then it can operate a diaphragm in the recorder. Now, this is a semi-floating recorder which has a very thin piece of glass in it, which has the cutting stylus in the middle of the piece of glass. Now, what am I waving it at?
Here.
So, but this is what all of the people who are going to be playing their instruments or using their voices have got to activate. That's what changes the depth of the groove on a cylinder, according to the sound that we're trying to record. And then when we've made the recording, we can play it back in exactly the reverse method, but using a round stylus that doesn't destroy the wax immediately, to reproduce it through another horn, which, as you'll see over there, is of a slightly different shape in order to throw the sound into the room rather than funnel it down onto the recorder. And that's basically it. And I'm open to questions, because somebody might have missed something there because I went through it quite quickly. Anyone want to know more about the setup yet? Yes.
How that I never understood how that can actually capture the wave and then cut the cylinder.
Right. Okay. Well, I'll borrow you for a minute then. let me just demonstrate. Well, you're going to be doing the first thing, so when you come up in a second, I'll show you something, and you can feel how it works. just need to get a screwdriver to do that. Yes, I'll show you how that feels. And it's actually quite an important thing to be able to do. He's just putting his head down so you can't see me or hear me. So I'm going to pop this recorder out, because this is the one we're going to use. I'll pop another one in that I'm not too precious about for today. So if you come up here, because we're ready to start some experiments now, I put the recorder in upside down, and that's the stylus. So come up, you come to the business end, you come to the recording end. Now, if you can rest your finger very gently on the middle of it, very gently. Now, when I speak into here, now do that sort of aha look into the camera, and people will realize what you're feeling, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So that's capable of moving very, very tiny distances. We're talking tiny, tiny fractions of fractions of a thousandth of an inch. But that vibration is entirely everything that you're doing at this end, causing that groove to be cut in a particular shape, which of course is an analogue of your voice. We like analogue. But of course you put your finger on it, so it's also digital. Right. Okay. So this is actually free. The recorder is free slightly to float up and down because the blank may not be absolutely spot on center or round, in which case it has to accommodate for that, or it might be slightly different thickness. So it floats, that's why it's called semi-floating. It floats that way, but it doesn't swing from side to side, otherwise it won't cut a consistent groove. Right, so this is the machine. That's the machine rotating at 160 RPM. See, I'm preempting all your questions here. Other speeds, as they say, were available. 160 became the main standard later in the later period of cylinders. Otherwise, sometimes if you had a long song, they just slowed it down and the quality went down, but you could fit the whole thing on. And then when it got to your playing it back at home, you didn't know what speed it was supposed to be. And now in 120 years later, everybody argues about whether that was a soprano or a baritone. So are you, have you the piece ready? Right. Okay, so we're going to let you experiment completely because we don't know whether this is going to overload. So if you felt there when it was vibrating, it is possible to put too much sound into it, and that causes it to leave the surface of the blank and cause what we call blasting. Mm-hmm. We, the limited number of people who do acoustic recording, call blasting. But otherwise a nasty sort of distortion. Now it's fine if you get that at the moment because we're going to do 20 seconds? We'll do a little bit of what you're going to do to get the idea of where you're supposed to be.
Okay.
I'm going to come around here so I can work this one in here. And right. And now here's the signal. When I put my arm like that, that means that you're going to start. Mm-hmm. And when I put my arm down, I won't keep it up. When I put it up the second time, it means I've taken the thing off and you can cheer or shout you can all cheer or shout at some point, but you could all make noise after that. So.
So we will go from the beginning to, I don't know,
just a couple of parts and then
To dici and then to this and up to here.
Yeah.
Okay. And then look, this is only one bar. So okay. I will start.
Okay.
Let's start from here.
Okay.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay.
Just to reach the
to
peak.
To reach the peak, because otherwise, I don't know, it's real weird.
Yeah.
Okay, super.
So the idea is we're doing a little piece of this piece, so we've got the dynamics, the loud bit and the quiet bit. I'm just doing that for non-technical members of the audience.
I want to see how it was. So okay. Just to see. Okay, we are ready.
Tu dici, alza il capo, raccogli con grazia i capelli in un nodo.
Playing it, I have a look to see whether it's cut all the way through. Yep, that looks clean enough. Yep, all right. Now, what we should have done is put some marks on the floor where you were standing, so we can work out whether we moved.
Oh.
piano is too, you know, it's too soft.
You can't hear it at all, okay? And I was loud, but that was not overbearingly loud, yeah.
You have to play.
I know.
Loud as you want.
Yeah, okay, super. Could we put this mic microphone
here? Yeah,
okay, super.
So, when it comes to the
purpose, so I'm just to see it's better to go less and then easier to go up, yeah, and then to kind of start cutting it, yeah. But this was super too soft, yeah.
Yes, so we are pointing over the top of it, so
yeah, okay.
Explain that if this was a 1902 recording studio, that piano would be another 3 foot up in the air, so the back of the piano would be at the level of the horn so that it could see it through or hear it.
So next week we'll put David's piano on a bit on this stage, just so we let you know. Thumbs up.
That's okay. And you could easily be quite a lot closer. The thing to do on most of these things is bracket it down, get close, and probably try and overload it. Don't deliberately, but just see where we get to the other side.
Okay.
So because there's more headroom on that. There's more space.
Okay. So yeah. Are we still trying 30 seconds or?
Yes. Yeah. Oh yeah, we might have slightly less than that, but yeah, I think you can work about that close in, and then when you feel the horn throwing it back at you, so try a little bit into the horn. Sing into the horn. I'll put it up a bit for you. So it needs to be at a good height for you. So just get close to that and see if that's nice for you. Is that okay?
Mm-hmm. Could be higher.
Yeah, that's fine. Okay. Keep saying.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Could we have that a little bit higher? Is that what your singing teacher used to say? A bit higher, a bit higher. Okay, so that's comfortably in line, so you can be in there. Just try it without me recording and just see if you can feel the sound coming back. It'll talk to you. Once you're that close to the horn, it'll come back to you.
Even if I talk,
yes,
it's coming back to me.
Yeah, so you get used to it. You also get used to when it's probably overloading a bit, so you'll be able to
feel it.
Or you might have to modify the way you sing. So it's up to you whether you move or modify the way that you sing.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, at this point, Inya has to, even on the quiet bits, has to hit the piano rather loud. Now, I did have an experience where somebody said, if I play that loud, I won't be able to hear the singer. And I said, if you can still hear the singer, you're not playing loud enough.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay. Oh, do you want to do a little test then? We've got plenty. We've got room on here.
Okay. She would run away.
So this is, shall I play a little bit of the end of the previous one so we can see the difference?
un nano.
The piano anyway, but we can't really do that today because we need to start putting more horns on it so we can point one at the piano. What might work better though, and might work, might be more comfortable to use, if I use the other horn, it will pick up more of the piano even when you've got your head in front of the horn, because you're blocking.
The horn is not small.
It's perfect. Yeah. We discussed how many horns we could use today. That's right. Recording engineer would now stick another horn on. And pointed at the piano so we get the accompaniment balance and the double mic-y. Can't do that today because of the bits and pieces we've got to do. But we can use a slightly bigger horn or slightly wider horn, which will have a different acoustic to it. When you start singing into this, you'll go, oh, that's different. And you'll notice in order to stop it rattling, it's had string put around it, which is not an uncommon technique in its day. Have a little sing into that and see what you get. Want to be up a little bit more for you?
If I have to be very close, yes.
Just come in as close as you can. Okay, so yes.
It's too low.
That is the difficulty. We're pointing over the piano, you see. They have to get you to crouch, kneel down, which is not a good singing position, really. No. Try that. Right, so I've filled that one.
Right.
Just have a little sing into it, see how that one feels, and tell me if it feels different.
Tu dici. It's better. It sucks less of my voice than well, for me, I can hear my voice a bit better.
Yeah. Should we try?
Yeah.
Which bit do you want to do?
The usual. Yeah.
Just do couple of loud notes for the intro, because it's not a long intro for a finished record, but we're doing a lot of...
Can I do the same? Because I'm...
That's the intro.
Just because
the intro.
Yes, okay. Hang on. Now we've got this on, I need to get that balance set with the whole... is lifting the recorder, which is because I'm having to put it up that height without putting it on something. Okay. Number three. How long have we got on this one? What are we doing for time? Because we can solve part of this problem just by pointing downwards, but it will mean we need to do the third option of the recording machine.
What are you doing?
Well, I have to bring the recording machine up so I can use this horn, and then it'll point down to the piano and the singer. But I need some help.
What do you need?
I need that trunk put on here when I lift the machine up.
Okay. Can somebody help with?
Okay.
No. Hey.
Hang on. And 100 years. Level work today. Right, completely different position. Can you come and stand in front so I can get the height right? We want to be up a bit more.
This is very much like the description I read of early singers recording into the horn.
Yes, yes.
Now
we need
I can't see anything, just the horn.
Now we need to get some strong people to hold. Check that your blank's properly pushed onto the mandrel. You get some very interesting noises.
Any questions while we are doing this?
They're just too stunned. Women are all sitting there waiting for their turn.
So I was wondering how the musical doses might be different if instead of Barbara we had like a tenor or a baritone.
Yes, it'll all be different. And sometimes, especially with sopranos, you have to put a thicker diaphragm in usually. Get that today. If we were doing a proper a studio recording, we'd have it adjusted in a different way. I can we'd have to be focusing on the piano, which is not what people are paying for this record for.
If I sing a bit farther from the horn, maybe the balance is
I want to concentrate on, if we can, is just getting a really good vocal recording, in which case, if you listen to that, you'll notice that you only need a tiny movement back to make a huge difference in the volume. So when you get to those louder bits, you're actually overcompensating at the moment.
I'm going to.
Yeah, because we want that dynamic. That's what creates the drama, the drama of the piece, but we're losing you completely.
You can see how quiet I am from the solo. That's why I wanted to have the four bar solo or intro, my intro. Because even that is too quiet. It's super, super quiet. That's because of the position of the horn. So it will be a little bit better I think in that context of ensemble, if you move out, but I will still be as quiet as the beginning. Because the horn is just pointing
It won't make the piano loud, it'll just make you quieter.
Yes, yeah. So then it will be seemingly more balanced, but it's not going to make me louder.
Okay.
Because you can see that from the introduction. It's just because it's so sensitive, very pointed, yeah? So,
okay.
that's the problem. I mean, you heard how loudly I played. It was unbearable. So that's great.
I have a comment on YouTube, which is not about the balance, which is mostly what we've been focusing on, but Paul Kusowski says, interesting how it highlights aspects of head production which are not clearly heard live.
Yeah,
and I have to say I agree with that.
Yeah, it's interesting to see all of it. So how about we run it and we listen to it and I would suggest, if as Duncan is saying, that if we were doing it, for reals, to produce a cylinder which is a proper studio cylinder. Oh,
this is going in the music department of Selfridges in 1902. You'd want to, you'd want to spend a little more time in getting there.
but I would suggest two horns for sure. Yeah, so it's so the balance is better, and even with those two horns, it was still, the piano would be less loud than the voice, because voice projects, and the piano is just everywhere. Yeah. So this piano actually is fantastic for recording, because it's very open sound, very like this. And on recording, it doesn't sound like that, yeah? It sounds very mellow, yeah? And if you have a mellow piano on recording, you don't hear. So it's very interesting.
So we have another question. I mean, you can answer it now.
Yeah.
Or that's Fatima Volkovisky, and she's asking, could you tell us about how your own voice sounds to you on the
cylinder? Good question.
You heard yourself being recorded with current technology, so what vocal qualities are lacking or perhaps too prominent for you in the cylinder recording?
I don't like my voice in the cylinder recording. I much prefer in the digital. I don't know. It's... although I'm trying not to sing vibrato, and in the last one I tried in some bars just to sing straight, still it's giving me a quality of vibrato that I never heard in digital recordings. And I think it's because it doesn't capture the whole range of my frequencies.
Yes, it's
so I don't hear the rest of the what for me and for the that from the CD is that lovely round fullness of the voice. Here it's sort of basic and with the vibrato very prominent. But yeah, that is what. So it's a bit
it's a bit disconcerting, really.
Yeah, it is. or perhaps I just need to get used to it.
Let's run it. But I think it's also very difficult to hear yourself without the piano support, because you hear only your voice with some plonking at the back, and you're like, what is this? So that is very weird, because to me it sounds unusual, not weird, unusual. Yeah, you never listen to it like that, but when you're practicing. So,
And if there's more test space on this one, or I can put the third one on and do the whole piece. Time-wise, I presume.
Yes, we should go for whole piece and move like
to the next.
Move to
the When
we come down from
the top notes, can we
top notes? Yes, but then can we go? I'm like still like when you are.
According to Henry Seymour, I wrote a book about the entire subject.
Then
what's made on dry days sound better than those made on dull, wet ones. And the recording engineer should, as far as possible, choose his weather. Unfortunately, we're in Huddersfield. She's tricky to choose your weather. It's a given, I think, those days. It's not too bad outside, is it?
It's very bright and dry.
It is actually, it is good for us. Now, I'd like to know from from the musician side of it, how much of that is the fact that actually when you've got instruments and you're playing them in the drier, slightly brighter weather, not too dry, yeah, in the right weather conditions, that they actually sound better?
They actually work better.
They work better.
It's
yeah.
Mechanical, they work better.
So Henry Seymour might have been at the other end of this, and actually it was the musicians who were going, yeah, it's a good day today, let's get on with it.
Let's go.
Okay. Okay. I'll wait for the reverb to die out. Okay. Are you ready behind the piano?
Yes. For that note.
I know, I didn't even hear what happened. No, I didn't hear.
Okay.
Good thing is that you will not be able to hear me, so I didn't mess up the cylinder.
Raccogli con grazia i capelli.
Cool. Well done.
Super. Recording the automata has been much more emphasized than they do.
Yeah,
somehow.
Uh-huh.
It feels like they feel more visceral
In the machine. Also, I think the chest, when I go into a sort of speaking voice in the lower notes, it feels chestier in the machine than that. I mean,
I was just
going to
ask if you considered using more tempo voice. I didn't even realize you were doing it.
Oh, super. Yeah, thank you. No, I was in the towards the end when it goes to C sharp, the lower, it seems. Yeah.